The man just sitting beside me asked me if I'm nervous. I must admit, I'm a little bit, because I'm not actually here for myself. I'm here to represent my colleagues. And to give you an idea, we're the Maritime Museum, Rotterdam, 50 staff members, 140 volunteers, and we share one thing: we have passion for our collection, and we have passion to tell stories about the maritime world. And all those people together have a real big commitment to tell the maritime, the beauty of the maritime world to everybody. We're located in the best place in the world to go to. That's not only my opinion, but Lonely Planet voted us one of the best top 10 places to visit in the world. So if you haven't been, please come to Rotterdam. And we're located in the middle of Rotterdam, in the heart of the city, on the exact spot where in 1600 the port of Rotterdam began. So you can't be any more historical than there, I think. We have a building and we have a harbor. The building exists of 3,200 square meters exhibition space. We have a library, we have a restaurant, we have educational spaces, and of course a big depot. And in our museum harbor, you will find our collection of cranes and vessels. We use that harbor not only for us, but it's also a public terrain. So people coming through the city can walk there, they bike there. Of course, it's Holland, so they bike. And it's a big part of the city, and our government also wants to make it the maritime district of Rotterdam and the place to be in our city. We want our visitors to do, and we want them to learn, and we want them foremost to experience. And whether that is by joining in our events, coming to see our exhibitions, or sailing on one of our historical vessels, they have to take part in what we do, and we want them to learn and experience and connect with them. But who are exactly our visitors? Here are some visitors. We have parents, grandparents, children, and last year we had over 230,000 visitors and 15,000 students visiting us with our schools. Our visitors are not the typical art museum visitors that come to see art. Our visitors are looking for a day out. They're looking for something new and they just want to have fun. And we believe, like the Dutch astronauts André Kuipers, that it's good to look behind the horizon, look further than you might think, dare to explore new things. And after all, that's not very different than the 17th century seafarers did. So a few years ago, we decided to change our course, to look at the future and to realize that success is based on cooperation and connection. We wanted to make a connection, not only tell stories. And it's not really surprising that we did it, because let me tell you something about our past. We were founded in 1874 by Prince Hendrik, better known as Prince Hendrik the Seafarer. Together with a group of maritime entrepreneurs, he wanted to show the wonders of the maritime world to a broad audience. They wanted to display the innovations that took place in the maritime world at that time and show everybody what it was to work and to live there. And they laid a foundation for a collection which is considered one of the top three maritime collections in the world. It's over 1 million objects. Our oldest ship model dates from the 15th century, the Mattereau model. It's the oldest Western ship model in the world. And we are very proud of that. We reach over six centuries of history because our latest acquisitions are really recent. We have a model of the Pioneering Spirit, for example, which is one of the largest offshore vessel at this moment. But we also, and it's been made at this exact moment, have a model of a shipping anchor that's used for heavy vessels at this moment, which is state of the art, and the company is donating us the vessel. The model. Please don't give any more vessels. And with this collection, we make exhibitions. We tell the story of 17th century explorers, but we also make exhibitions that are more lighthearted. So, like, for example, an exhibition on cruising. We choose to make an exhibition that's fun. So we tell the story that cruising is fun. Even some people don't really agree with that. Or we make an exhibition called Fashion Ahoy, which is about fashion that's inspired by the maritime world. We follow a few guidelines. A project has to be able to reach emotions, and it has to connect to your personal life. And I think one of the best examples for that is an exhibition we made, Sex and the Sea, We made it together with Peter Greenaway, the filmer. And for me, the best example for the ability to make a connection is that in one of the movies made for that exhibition, a sailor had his coming out, not only for his family, for his colleagues, but also for 230,000 people visiting our museum. It's that only person, if I can make a connection to those persons, I think we've been great. We also, at this time, have an exhibition on show. It's called Drugs in the Sea. You might know that Rotterdam is one of the biggest transfer ports for drugs. And it has a major effect not only on our city, but also on the country. But just imagine the effect it has of if people working in our harbor are asked if they can borrow, if we can borrow your key so I can make a drugs delivery. We've noticed that that exhibition has been visited by a lot of companies that sent all of their employees to us. So they don't send them to experience the art of experience history. They use it as a tool for human resource, because they want to explain to their employees what it is when you're asked to do something that will have an effect on the rest of your life. We do the same with school groups, with children from less privileged areas in Rotterdam. By explaining them, the effects of drugs, and I must say, a lot of them have lots and lots more experience with it than we have. We want to make change. We want to really have an impact on their future. Because actually, that's what we consider our core value. We want to change lives and perhaps even futures by introducing people to an unknown world. So a couple of years ago, we went on a new path. Traditionally, our programs focused on telling the stories of the past, but we decided that we wanted to tell the stories of the present and the future. And in order to do that, we made a connection with the maritime industry, because that's where the innovation is taking place. If you want to tell the stories about the maritime world, it is about maritime companies. So we connected with them. And if you follow that path, it's really easy and really obvious that, for example, we join in a day where it's focused on International Girls' Day, where we introduce children to and girls to technique. So we had a new focus on technique. And that meant that in December 2016, we opened the Offshore Experience, a state-of-the-art 800 square meter experience while people enlist to become a trainee on a production platform far away at sea. This project was a trigger for our new approach, because it was made in close cooperation with the industry. 56 companies joined in this project. They donated us with collection, because nowhere in the world there's a national offshore collection. We don't have objects concerning this fairly new part of history. They provided us with knowledge. We didn't have a curator knowing anything about the industry. And also they gave us money to make the exhibition possible. This, of course, was a really new approach. And we had a lot of colleagues very on our back, because they said it's not ethical to work with the industry that close. I really think we did a good job. And I can really proudly say ethics was really served. We did it in a good way. They never had the real... they didn't tell us what to do. We made it, and we were also able to have new audiences in our museum. Because what we saw, that a lot of people working in the offshore industry that never came to the museum, now came to the museum with their families. They actually had a place to show what they were doing. If you work offshore, there's no family days. You go there by helicopter, nobody can go there. Now they could come to the museum and show things. We had a lot of businesses doing business events at our museum. So instead of going to a congress hall to have your dinner, to have your meetings, they would come to us and do their meetings in an environment that suited their purposes. But we also made a connection on our educational programs. Together with YINC, a foundation that strives for a society in which a child's background doesn't determine its child's future, we developed a program that goes beyond our museum. Teenagers that visit our museum have a workshop in our classroom after they visit the experience. The next step is the real world. with a fast, really fast, and nice internship. In small groups of 8 people, they go to a company and they experience the real thing. They get in a gear and are able to do things. And that experience is marvelous. I can only say from my experience, walking into a production hall of a maritime company where everything is big, everything is huge and impressive, that is an experience you'll never forget. And for us, that's a way to introduce children and teenagers to technique, because in Holland, we know we will get a lot of problems with finding the right persons in the future to take part in all the occupation for technique. And of course, we also have the real vessels in our harbor. These vessels are maintained by a lot of our volunteers. These volunteers have enormous skills. They have enormous knowledge. But as you might see, their age is also fairly above 50. So in order to make sure that we preserve their knowledge, we cooperate with companies and with schools to make sure those skills get passed over. Our volunteers learn, they teach the students, but they also learn from the people and from all the people working in the industry that come to us and tell us things. Being voted Best Technical Museum of the Year 2018 was actually the best proof that our efforts to change our museum had proven successful. After all, this is a contest where our users get to tell us what they feel. It's not an award from a specialized professional audience. We got a few with this project, but actually I think this is the best thing because it told us that people liked what we're doing. The Museum of the Year contest is an award initiated by the National Bankiero Loterij Lottery, the Museum Association and the Prins Bernhard Fonds. The people vote. And in total, there was a huge amount of votes. It's more than 100,000 votes. We got 37.4%, which is more than 42,000 votes. That's the highest amount of votes that was ever given to this award. We're very proud of that. It's the connection. And although I'm not able to actually see who voted, I know a lot of the companies we were involved with, for example, had campaigns to help us. The total industry was able to help us get the vote. With it also comes prize money, 100,000 euros. We're going to spend that money on our new pavilion. Opening end of 2020, the demolition of the present buildings is starting in a couple of months. We're opening a new Leuvenhaven pavilion, right in the middle of the Maritime District, very close to our museum. This pavilion is going to host a couple of things. The Port of Rotterdam is going to make an information center in it. In this center, people can go to learn about the present harbor, but also, like for example, plan trips to go into the harbor. And in Rotterdam, the harbor is only almost 40 kilometers away. There's going to be a restaurant, a big restaurant, which will play an important part in the cultural and atmosphere in the city. And we are going to have our main workshops in it. Interactive technical workshops where we maintain our fleet. So it's going to be actual work, but where we can also have school groups in and where all the visitors coming to our museum, passing by, can come in and see what we're doing. We're going to combine all techniques with new innovations so we can introduce everybody to the splendor of the maritime world. I must say a special thanks to all the people involved in winning this award. Of course, the Bankieren Loterij, the Prins Bernhard Cultuurfonds, the Museumvereniging, but all the companies involved, all the working on this change, and of course, everybody that voted. They made us help and come and make our dream come true. In 2024, we will be celebrating our 150 years anniversary. I just learned yesterday that, this morning, that I need to bake a really big cake for that. And lots has changed in these years. The world's shipping has, our world has, the population of Rotterdam has, It's totally different than 150 years ago. We have to change. We did. And I think that we're only going to change even more. The thing that stayed is that we want to inspire our visitors to do, experience and learn. But learning goes both ways. It's making about, it's making a connection. And that's what we want to do for the future. And I urge you all to look behind and beyond the horizon, because there is the new future, and there is things that might give you the best information. Thank you.